Hello everyone! What we have here is a Raspberry Pi 0W and a 6502 single board computer with a common OLED screen attached. We're using the 6502 computer as an old school serial terminal so we can check out the boot progress of the Pi and send it commands without anything else attached. In this video, we'll be teaching the 6502ino, as I call it, how to hardware scroll the OLED screen since clearing the whole screen and writing the next line of text from the top of the screen like we did in the last video isn't just a frustrating viewing experience, it's also a horribly inefficient way to get to write more text on the screen. We already went through how to make the 6502ino into a basic serial terminal, and in the preceding videos we wrote all the code we need to do that, like basic input-output, blinking an LED, doing I2C, serial, and writing a library to control the OLED screen. We did all that from scratch in 6502 assembly on a more limited system than you probably imagine if you're new to this channel. A 1 MHz 6507 CPU using a 6532 Riot with only 128 bytes of RAM. But if it was good enough for the Atari 2600, I think we can get a lot more out of it too. If you like tinkering with electronics, and especially the 40 to 50 year old kind of electronics, you've come to the right place. If you're already trained in MOS technology 6502 computers, assembly language programming, and know how the 6532 Riot works, you might be able to follow along with this video. Otherwise, you might want to check out some of my other videos, maybe my single breadboard computer video. You might have noticed in the last video I said we could maybe use the scrolling feature of the OLED screen to do what we want here. But actually, that's the only thing the scrolling feature doesn't do. What we want is plain vertical scrolling, but if we look at the graphic acceleration commands, we only have the option of horizontal scrolling or both horizontal and vertical scrolling. Automatic horizontal scrolling is a pretty sweet feature to have when we want to write games for this platform later. Without a horizontal scrolling feature in the display, it would be a lot harder to make side-scroller games like Super Mario or Flappy Bird, but the feature doesn't help us much here. Luckily, it's not because a vertical scrolling feature is missing from the display, but just because we're looking in the wrong place. Vertical scrolling is a lot simpler since it's just an offset from the top of the screen. So to get what we want, we simply use the command setDisplayOffset D3hex. That should also mean it's pretty easy to code, so let's see. Since we don't need to put the code in a permanent ROM while we're testing, we can just load it into our useLand segment in RAM via serial. Let's try scrolling the screen at the press of one of our buttons here on the breadboard from the last video. To keep track of how much we're scrolling, we can borrow the mode variable since we're not using it in userland. Since we have all the routines we need for sending commands to the OLED via I2C and ROM already, we can just send out a display offset command by D3 with the SSD1306 command routine, followed by the mode variable we increment by 8 and save each time before sending it out. To wait for a button press on the right button, we simply check bit 7 of DRA with the bit instruction and branch on the plus minus flag. If the button is pressed and the corresponding bit is connected to ground, the negative flag will be clear and we branch on plus to scroll again. And if the pin is high because the button isn't pressed, the negative flag will be set, so we branch on minus to check the button until the button is pressed. Since the screen is clear before we run our userland code, we need to write something on the screen to scroll. So we can just steal the normal welcome message and print that on the screen before we start scrolling. And since we probably don't have enough RAM for this and the code from the last video, we'll just comment that out. Now let's see if it works. Well, that was easy. We are now scrolling the screen. I guess we can call it a day already. In the next video, just kidding. We're not quite there yet, as what we actually want is for the screen to start scrolling when the cursor hits the end of the screen and not just when we press a button. And it also looks like we're scrolling the wrong direction, which makes sense since adding to an offset from the top would push the content down and thereby scrolling up. Or maybe it's just scrolling really fast the right way. So if we subtract 8 instead of adding, we should scroll the right direction, I guess. Since we keep deducting 8 from the scroll value, we'll eventually roll over or under the 64 possible offsets, but since the display doesn't seem to care about bit 6 and 7 of the offset value, we don't have to do anything to keep it in the range of 0 to 63. Now that we have some code that'll let us scroll down a line, we might as well make that into a subroutine. Of course, we can't keep using the mode variable to keep our scroll value, so we need a new memory location for that. And then we just grab it and paste it, let's say above the send character routine. Then we rename it to keep the SSD 1306 naming convention, and we can test it out by replacing the clear screen when the screen rolls over with a scroll. Of course, that probably won't work out, since I have a feeling the cursor position doesn't take the offset into account, but let's find out. Oh, it looks like I forgot to grab a memory location for the scroll variable and missed some renaming. Since we're taking an extra location, we have to rewrite the memory map as well as defining it. Let's see what that does. We can just write some text via serial and see what happens. Oh, something's not right. We keep writing the last line since we reset the cursor position to 112, and that's what we should expect, but it's scrolling the opposite way. I guess the offset is an offset to where in the display RAM it starts reading and not where on the screen it starts writing. I guess I could have figured that out if I read the datasheet a bit more carefully. So to scroll down, we add to the offset. I think we have it right this time. We also found out that the cursor position conclusively doesn't take the offset into account, so we can't use that for cursor positioning anymore. At least not without some more math. What we can try instead is to scroll down one line every time we go to a new line after the first time the cursor position would roll over to the top of the screen. Since we need to keep track of whether we started scrolling or not, and probably other things in the future, we can use a terminal flags byte. I'll just call it tflags and only scroll when bit 0 is set. Again, we need to use another byte of RAM, and we could probably optimize the memory map a bit to use less RAM for variables, but let's let that be a problem for the future. Okay, it looks like I forgot the renaming already, but that's an easy fix. But I also broke another pin after all. Luckily, we have another one on standby. That's not what I was expecting. Looks like we're stuck on the same line and don't start scrolling. I wonder what happens if we ignore our new terminal flag and just scroll every time. Yes, it looks like that works as expected. Control C works too, but of course pressing Enter doesn't scroll as we haven't written that code yet. Either way, I call this progress. Let's reactivate the scroll flag and see if we can't get it working and also add it to the new line routine. And of course, we should also reset the scroll flag when we clear the screen. And we have to clear the scroll offset setting in the display after clearing the screen too. It looks like we're starting to get some branching range errors. I'll try to optimize those out the way, but it looks like we're going to need a jump instead of just a branch. You might have noticed I folded sending zeros into a loop. A few less bytes, but not enough. Let's see where we are now. It looks like we're on the first line after we start scrolling, which isn't what we want, but at least it keeps scrolling like we should expect. More progress. Let's see if we can't fix that bug by scrolling an extra time when we start scrolling. Okay, that did something, but certainly not what we want. It could be the issue is we don't enable scrolling if we wrap around using the new line instead of the send character routine, so let's add that check. Yay! It actually scrolled the way it was supposed to. Of course, it doesn't clear the new line we're overwriting, but it works. But for some reason, we just ended up in the middle of the screen. I guess we're relying too much on the cursor position somewhere. I guess it could also be that we're reactivating scrolling every time the cursor wraps around and scrolling an extra time every time we do. So let's skip that if scrolling is already active. Now it looks like we're pretty close to the system scrolling the way it's supposed to, so I'm curious to see what it looks like if we boot the Raspberry Pi now. We're still getting lots of buffer overflows, of course, and after logging in, we're getting this strange sequence of characters when I press the Enter key, even though I know it would normally just repeat the current shell line. I wonder what that's about. To give us a bit more headroom and maybe reduce the buffer overflow slightly, let's try lowering the baud rate to 4800 baud. All it takes is a tiny bit of simple math. All we have to do is to extend our bit delays by another 104 microseconds for a total delay of 208 microseconds, and since we already have all the overhead included, and one delay count is 8 cycles at 1 MHz, we just add 13 to our current delay count. Yay, 4800 baud. That was easy. To get the Pi to play along, we just grab the SD card and edit command line.txt for our new lower baud rate. I can't really see if that made much of a difference, and since we're not doing any work during the bit delays, it shouldn't really make much of a difference. I wonder how slow we have to go to be able to write a character to the screen during the bit delay. We should probably take a look at that in another video. As Andrew Eastland pointed out in the comments for the last video, really old terminals typically use the form feed character to clear the screen. I assume simply because that would have the same effect on a teletype. By changing the clear screen character to 0C hex, we have to press Ctrl L to clear the screen instead of Ctrl C. I have a feeling our timeout when receiving serial data is way too long, since our decrement of timer 2 actually takes about 16 cycles. And if we multiply that by 64, we're still at 1024 microseconds of delay, and even that is probably too much, as it would be weird to wait 5 bit lengths between bytes. Also, the buffer overflow message is a bit long, since it takes quite a long time we could be using to print actual data from the buffer, so let's shorten that to BOF, or just OF. Oh, and it looks like I forgot to fix it so we don't start writing outside the buffer zone, which would write in the tiny part we have reserved for stack. Let's see if that still works before we move on. We still have to fix it so scrolling clears the last line before we write to it. Well, at least to me, it looks like we're getting a few more readable characters and less junk data, but still too many overflows and framing errors to catch everything. And it's also hard to see if the last line is the old one or the newly overwritten one. Let's reuse the code from the backspace routine to erase the last line in the scroll routine. So we just paste that and change the loop count to 128 to erase the whole line instead of just a single character. After clearing the row, we just need to reset the column. And when I copy code, I have to remember to rename the labels, of course. Let's see what happens when the first line scrolls up. Yay! It was overwritten like it should, and we can press enter a few times to clear the screen completely. But of course we can't scroll back up, because we don't have a buffer copy of the line we erased. Something is still a bit off, as we're suddenly writing to the middle of the screen. It looks like when I press backspace a few times, it messes up the cursor position. First of all, it no longer makes sense to prevent backspace from underflowing to the last character, since when we're scrolling, that'll just be the line above it. So, let's try to fix that. Since we don't want to subtract 1 and end up at 255, we set the accumulator to 128 if we loaded a 0. Besides being able to roll under, we should also deactivate scrolling when we erase past the beginning of a line. Mostly so we don't scroll when we reach the end of that line again. Here comes the fun. No, it didn't. It looks like that broke backspace completely. Ah, my bad. I have a branch equal instead of a branch not equal here. With that fixed, it still looks like something is a bit off. Somehow, I still end up with a bad cursor position. Maybe when I press enter a few times, or maybe it's backspace. It kind of seems like the new line doesn't always turn on scrolling. Of course. New line is depending on the cursor position to figure out if it should turn on scrolling or not, but that doesn't make sense when scrolling might have been activated and the last line cursor position no longer matches the last line on the screen. Basically, what we have to do is to add the scroll position to the current cursor position so we start scrolling after the last line. Before adding though, we have a little unit conversion problem, as one line is 8 counts in our scroll variable and 16 in the cursor position counts. But we can just fix that by doubling the scroll count after loading it. And if we remember our binary arithmetic, that's just a shift to the left. After adding that, we have to remember to throw away the top bit, since the scroll variable might have that set. Now that I think of it, we'll have the same problem with the send character routine, so let's fix that too. Also, since we kept the cursor in the accumulator before, but now we have it with the scroll offset added, we need to load the cursor value again. Okay. That should make a difference. But not exactly a great one. Somehow we end up on the top line when we start scrolling instead of the bottom one. Oh. In the new line routine, it's not a problem that we're throwing away the top bit as well as the bottom bit, since we only care about the line number. And the bottom bits should be zero anyway, but when taking scrolling into account, we can't throw away the bottom bits without running into trouble. So we end with 7F instead of 7-0 in the send character routine. That should improve things. Except we're still on the wrong line. I guess we can skip the extra scroll when we start scrolling. With that in place, things still aren't quite right. But when I press backspace, things seem to fall into place. So I'm assuming it must have something to do with resetting the cursor position correctly when we erase a character and incorrectly when we use the new line routine. Basically, it looks like the display cursor isn't where we think it is at some point. It also looks like we're missing one count in the send blanks loop, since that's also responsible for sending the data command byte first, making the total 129. I have a feeling something else is up too, but let's see where we're at. That wasn't much of an improvement, and it still looks like the new line breaks our cursor position and backspace somehow fixes it. Sadly, you can't see what I'm typing, which would make it easier to see what's wrong here, but I hope you'll take my word on it that it's still broken. It looks like we might need to reset the column a few places, and there's some efficiency to be gained by having a dedicated character return routine, so we might as well make one. We can just copy our set column routine and hard code it for the zero column. Maybe it's better to enable scrolling before setting column and line after a new line, so we can move the scroll check. At least we can try. But that doesn't look like the right way around. I'm not sure if it's obvious, but you can actually see that sometimes the line is cleared from the middle of the line to the middle of the next, since the cursor position isn't reset before clearing the last line. So let's put that back the way it was, but it also gave me a hint what's going on with the wrong line positions. If we write a whole page, or 128 columns, and the display is in horizontal addressing mode, I think we'll inadvertently reset the column to the first position of the wrong line, since completing a whole line will increase the display page pointer. But if we abuse the fact that the last column will always be blank, since we're using a zero padded 8x8 pixel font, we don't have to clear all 128 columns and can just skip writing the last column. So when we reset the column, we'll still be on the same page. Let's see if we're getting close. Test, test, test. Test, and all is good. Now what about backspace? Works fine, and also disable scrolling. And does scrolling work again? Yep, just like we intended. We now have a working SSD 1306 library in 6502 assembly with vertical hardware scrolling support. Now we can try plugging in the Pi again, and we should see some improvement. But of course we still haven't found a way around our buffer overflow issue, so we still get a bunch of overflows and framing errors spitting out junk until the buffer recovers. My videos usually aren't this coding intensive, but I didn't just want to skip this part about getting scrolling working. What would you like to see me make? Leave a comment and come join the clubhouse on Discord. In the near future, I have some more hardware-oriented projects I'd like to show off, and maybe I'll succeed in chopping them into smaller parts so I can release videos a bit more frequently than once a month. Either way, thanks for watching.